Welcome to episode number 7 of Studio Tapped, where we bring you an inside look of a website development and design studio. I'm Patrick Smith, founder of C2 Creative.
And I'm Heather Acton, founder of Helio Interactive. Yeah.
So let's start the podcast. So Heather, you've got all the topics over there. I'm woefully unprepared as usual, so I'll kind of let you kick off the...
Yeah, if I don't make some sort of topic list and we just go into this, I tend to really... Yeah. As if I don't falter enough already, I falter even more. So I had my hour car ride down that I had a pad of paper and a pen next to me that every time I had an idea, I just wrote it down. And at least I get a little bit in the mindset to do this. Mm-hmm. I'm not as natural as you. I just can't right. sit and podcast.
Few people are.
I know, exactly. So I feel like with an hour of preparation ahead of time, I can almost pull my weight in this.
Yeah.
So that was the objective. So one of the topics I thought of that we haven't talked about yet and is kind of a fun one is all the stuff internally that we're working on as we call our combined non-company Chelio 2, C2 around Helio. And we do have a lot of cool kind of underground stuff going on, this podcast included probably. This is the only one, though, that we've ever talked about on here. So I thought we need to say, like, what are some other things that we do besides just client projects?
Yeah. Yeah, what do we do?
Well, you kind of started it, the poster a week idea, I thought. That was a really neat thing, and I know you've done it sometimes and not done it sometimes, but who cares? That's not the point.
Yeah.
It does happen sometimes, and so maybe talk about why did you start doing that and your inspiration for it, and how do you think it helps?
A lot of questions there, Heather. Let's take them one at a time. So what
beginning.
Is it? So poster a week was, if you're on Instagram or... I think it's primarily Instagram. There's all these poster a day, poster a week, kind of, I wouldn't call them challenges, but just hashtags. And as I was going through them last year, I thought there was some nice work being done. And at the time, you know, 2016, I thought we should not stop doing client work, but let's start doing some kind of design exercise just for ourselves or for myself, you know, in terms of it was something that I wanted to do and a couple of designers started to do it as well. Unfortunately, I wasn't as disciplined as I would have liked to have been just because of the workload that kind of came my way. But I was probably pretty consistent for the first couple of months doing it. And it was just more of a way to break or stop thinking about client problems and start doing some organic design exercise exploration kind of things. And there's a lot of cool tech for me personally. There's a lot of cool techniques out there that I thought, I was like, man, I don't know how to do that. Or I don't know how that guy or girl pulled that off. I want to see if I can recreate that, you know, and in my own version or whatever. So to be honest, a little bit of it was, you know, how can I, kind of not master, I wasn't going to master anything in a week, but try on some of those styles that I wouldn't normally ever approach just in our client work or just personally, and see if I can figure out how to execute on a certain technique or just a general idea, just a concept. But kind of the parameters for myself that I said is let's give ourselves an hour, you know, come up with the idea and execute it in an hour. So that's not a lot of time. And there's a range of these poster a week or poster a day things, and some people must have a lot of time on their hands. they do some pretty intricate things that are cool. And there's some that are really basic and straightforward and kind of just very basic. But, you know, I think they're doing it for the same reason that I was suggesting, just to keep it going or just a exercise, design exercise kind of approach. So... there's probably one or two that I did that I really like and I would like to revisit and do something else around those ideas. A few were just, you know, pretty bad.
that's the point, though, yeah, right? Is they shouldn't all come out a masterpiece. It lets you at least try something new. If it's great, great. If it fails, that's okay,
too. Yeah. What I noticed, and this is, I kind of had a feeling this was going to happen. There were a couple techniques that I really liked. And a technique without an idea is usually a trap to go off the road. But I said, you know what? I don't care right now. I'm just going to try it and see if I can figure out how this person executed X, Y, or Z. So, in the process of, I just reminded myself, you know, start with the idea first, and then this technique part of it you layer on top. I didn't go in there with it. This wasn't a big conceptual exercise either. It was more of just comparing and contrasting different looks that I liked. The one thing that happens a lot in these, there's almost like a formula for a lot of these designers. So mm-hmm. I didn't want to do a formula and just keep kind of generating the same look and feel and styles. I'm like, I'm going to try to recreate something that looked like this guy's, and then this person's, and then that person's, and then that girl's, whatever, and just try on a kind of be a chameleon for a while and try a bunch of different things. If I can get to a place here in the next few months or a few month or two where I have the bandwidth to kind of get my head back into it, I'd like to do that again. There's also an AIGA, the American Institute for Graphic Design, or Graphic Arts, excuse me, and the Chicago chapter is going to have a poster contest too. If I can get some bandwidth, I'm going to try and execute on something like that. I need to get more involved with the AIGA here in Chicago, the local chapter. So that's one of my to-dos in the next, you know, it's kind of like the WordCamp.
It would help get two things kind of moving. Keep going with this concept of the poster day or poster week and get you involved in that organization.
And there was the other thing. My dream when we started this thing was that we were going to have time to do this and there we'd be able to execute and follow through on it. But was to try to involve some other local Chicago designers. And then this was the fantasy part, right? So sometime at the end of June, 6 months in, what I really wanted to do was reach out to like 5 or 6 or 10 or however many people that were doing it in the Chicagoland area. And not have a party, but have some kind of get together for an hour or two, and maybe just do kind of a group show and tell of everything we've done. Get a chance to meet people, you know, in real life, and kind of talk about the work, have a drink.
It's a fun meetup. I think it would have been really cool.
Yeah. And the vision was to get projected. Like I don't know what restaurant or bar this would happen at, but get everyone loads up their files into a PDF or JPEG, whatever it is, and we project them, you know, throughout the night, and maybe we print some out. It would have been just kind of fun just to get, you know, a dozen people or so.
Why do you say would have been? Like, you don't still want to do it? Or I think that's a really
I think it's a great idea. It's been a challenge. So maybe we'll do it, you know. Hey, there's always next year, you know. But what I'd like to do is get back on track, maybe restart it in the second half of the year, and then see if some other people would be interested in doing that. Make it a thing, you know. It'd be kind of fun. There's plenty of other kind of art groups out there that do similar kind of stuff. This was one way just to get a bunch of people that are doing this specific thing to mm-hmm. Have some fun with it. So and some of the ones, there's one freelancer that we had some email exchanges, and he does some really cool stuff. A very different approach. The designer was from Australia, and he's had a really cool kind of conceptual approach to his stuff. Like there were a lot of the posters that he was doing had, you know, messages, you know, deeper meaning than the stuff mm-hmm. that I was doing in an hour. But they were fun, and they had a sense of humor, and I like that. So that's the kind of stuff I'd like to start doing when we talk about design community and, you know, getting involved in that and creating some new friendships, new friends, new, you know, building the network a little bit more, and you know,
expanding horizons,
build a network, you know, all that stuff.
It's interesting. I forgot about this piece, but the first abstract episode, I think this is the one I only kind of halfway paid attention to. It was way out there as far as design thinking and stuff. But anyways, it was about a guy. I think he designs the New Yorker covers, and he had a specific challenge to design a New Yorker cover for an iPad that kind of mimicked AR or VR. And so it was this three-dimensional, like, moving cover for the New Yorker. So kind of cool concept. So anyways, they take you through this guy's, like, daily routine and how he thinks about himself as a person and how it relates to being a designer and all these things. And he's adjusted his person, like his personality, so that he's better suited to be a better designer. It's kind of crazy. But anyways, one of the things he does is he takes, I can't remember if it's in, I think it's an hour every day, and gives himself total creative freedom to do whatever it is he wants to do. And the one that they showed was he had a coffee cup with like coffee on the bottom of it, like if it had spilled over, and he just set this coffee cup on a piece of paper, so it made kind of a cool like crescent of a coffee stain on the sheet, and then he just took it and drug it across the sheet, so it just is a circle with like, you know, streaks behind it or whatever. And then they should fast, you know, they do time lapse of him drawing, and he turns it into this like lady running through rain with an umbrella or something. Yeah. It's just like beautiful at the end. And he's like, I didn't plan, it's not at all what I planned, it's nothing, it was just how he naturally, when he doesn't think about meeting a deadline or client objectives or bigger meaning behind it, and just goes like, it's sometimes where some of the best art comes through. But
yeah, I mean, yeah, no, our days are full of putting together rationales of why are the, this piece, why this color or this font is the perfect solution for this business problem. And sometimes, you know, there is a reason for those things, but we make way too much of a, we put way too much in, not we, but I think the world puts way too much effort and energy into those things. They are important, and there's time and place for them. But there's a lot to be said for doing things and trying them out and seeing where it goes. And not to be flip about it or be strategic about it at all. It's just there's sometimes it's you got to make a choice or and do something like this just to do go through the exercise. So that's the stuff that I really want to start doing more of here. And anyway, so that's awesome stuff. I think I saw that episode. I think I was falling asleep when I was watching.
Yeah, we watched it here one night, halfway watched it that time, and then halfway watched it the next time. Like that one just didn't pique my interest quite the same, except for some of these small pieces.
I've tried to watch that one like two or three times on YouTube, and it, for whatever reason, I'll start it, and then the phone rings or something else has happened, and I haven't completed it. So, anyway.
Yeah. Cool. So poster week is going to go, and it's going to turn into a meetup. That's wonderful.
Yeah, sure. Let's get that going.
Got it going. That's a good one. So this podcast is another, we don't have to dig real deep into this one, but this podcast was another internal idea slash project that we at least started. So I think we're pretty happy with, this will be technically episode 7, something like that.
Yeah, technically.
Yeah, technically. We're still, I would say, in practice mode and figuring out all of what it's going to be and what's the flow and what are the topics, but it's been neat. We put up a website kind of sort of for it. I think it's just got like a picture in the title or something, but I think eventually we'd like to have a feed of
what. Do we really?
Yeah. GoStudioTap.com.
Really?
Yeah. I think I showed it to you. It was like I needed something fun to do for a few hours, so I literally just did a very, very basic setup and put a picture up there, and that's about it. But I'd love to have like that. That's where our show notes can go and have a feed of the of all the episodes, and you know, maybe there's some other accompanying stuff on there. I'm not really sure yet, but another internal project that like with all of them, right? You take them in pieces, and I think for us it was a big thing to just get the equipment. You did the setup, and we started actually doing these, and that's a start, and then we'll take it to the next level. So
I just went the URL. It's pretty funny.
Why is it funny?
You did tell me about this, but I just haven't.
Yeah. That's all. I think that is literally all it is, right? Yeah. I think I set up a Slack channel and email addresses to get us closer to the spot where if we wanted to say, you know, hey, if you want to be a part of the Studio Tap community, you know, sign up here. Here's your Slack channel invite, and then people could maybe post questions.
Got it.
And there we could answer them on the podcast. Maybe we get interviewed, you know, people who want to be interviewed or have something to add, then we could bring them in. So all things that in time I think will come together. But
cool. Yeah, I love it. It says contact. This theme has address 123 Main Street, New York, New York.
the most generic generic address ever. I should probably change that at least to 123 North Jefferson.
Or we could just, but, you know, some fictitious.
Yeah. Nobody should know it. It shouldn't even pop up in search right now, because I don't even know that it says this is a podcast or anything.
Yeah.
It's don't know.
You're correct. So, anyway, so that's something to do. That's,
yeah, well, that'll, pretty that's, basic. So, you know, but it's, yeah, it's fun to, yeah, fun to have. It's similar to the poster day. It's like sometimes you're all in and you're stoked about doing it and you've got the time, mm-hmm, and then other times you got to scale back on your internal project, mm-hmm, because of client work or motivation or whatever, yeah, it may be. So
totally.
All natural, all natural.
Mm-hmm.
So the other one I've been playing with, and I don't know that this will ever come to fruition or not, but I had a day last week where maybe it's kind of like that poster day thing. I just needed to think about something else and do something else. And the thing for some reason that I felt like doing was wireframing our agency management dashboard. I think we have a conversation. We were kind of bashing agency management systems, so I kind of started to look at them again, and I was like, it would be really nice to not use all these separate systems, or at least have some sort of a high level view of things, like what are all the active projects going on, what to dos are due next, what invoices aren't paid yet that we should be following up with people on, what are some people that we've been talking with that maybe we need to follow up with to see if they need a proposal or respond to our proposal, like just this high level view of what's everything going on in the business that we could use to be a little bit more efficient, instead of right now I still feel like so much is up in our heads of remember to do this and don't forget about this and oh, this is in this system and that's in this in that system. So I did kind of start to wireframe out just what that front page would look like, and the initial responses I got was lofty goals. we'll see if this ever goes live. And
who
some
said
of these,
that?
I don't know. It's probably from me, actually. Who knows if it'll ever come to fruition? I think was my exact thought.
Oh, it was your thought? I thought someone commented on it.
Yeah. Leo did. Leo was the one that. Oh, Leo said ambitious. I think was his comment,
yeah,
and
okay,
it is.
Got
it's,
it.
It's super ambitious. But I'm. My thought is. One, I've enjoyed, I don't get to wireframe things often, but I do actually enjoy that process.
Mm-hmm.
So it was partially just, I felt like wireframing something and this was what was in my head, like a problem we needed to solve. I think the other piece that goes into it is having a product to sell versus, you know, maybe we would be able to potentially license this to other folks or license the suite of solution. Like, hey, we're an agency that uses Harvest, Asana, and Slack, I think, was the other one I want to hook in here somehow. And here's a dashboard that pulls in and feeds back information to those three systems and, you know, kind of helps somebody just get a quick start for their suite of things they need to run their agency versus, I think, all of us tried.
Did you say Harvest, too?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I think so.
Yeah,
I think so.
Yeah,
if I miss
Slack,
it,
Slack, Asana, Harvest.
Harvest are kind of the big three. I feel like I am missing one, but... Or even to see, you know, somebody who to help avoid people, you know, trying FreshBooks for a while and then figuring out, okay, when you get to this point, you can't use FreshBooks anymore. What should you use next? I think there's we've got a lot of experience with a lot of different platforms. We've used two different versions of Basecamp, and now we've kind of stuck on Asana a little bit. We used Skype for all communications before Slack came along, and now we use Slack and. Email, I think you were actually, maybe you did always have Google Apps, but I've seen different email systems that people have set up. So it's kind of like, what's your full, what did we talk about before, digital infrastructure?
Yeah.
We could almost, instead of being that to our clients, I think there's something to be said for other, you know, freelancers starting out or smaller agencies, you know, instead of doing all the research yourself and figuring out what works, how about we help you with what all works? And oh, by the way, we've got this dashboard that pulls it all together for you. So as the business owner, you don't have to remember to hop into six different things to see what's going on. You've got this high level view of where things are at.
Yeah.
In the key areas.
Be very, so, very niche is what it would be.
Yeah, super,
I mean, super
niche.
Right.
Exactly, super niche. And the programming of it is stuff that I've never done before, but I've kind of wanted to learn, and so I don't know if this will really come to play, but it's using the APIs of Asana.
That's what I was going to say. Wouldn't you just be pulling in API data and... I don't even.
Yeah,
and
that's
it's just
all
the design
is.
On top of it, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's being able to pull the right data and push the right data back and manipulate it into the way that you want to. That I've never pulled anything from an API
before.
It's all
data anyway.
I know it's all data, but it's knowing the the part where I tend to not get so excited. It's like I get what the solution is. Like I can say, oh, we need to do this, but the actual programming to make it happen, because it's like JSON or whatever.
Yeah.
The programming to make it happen is. I can't decide if I really do have an interest in learning it or not. Leo's done some API stuff with Twitter.
Uh-huh.
So he might be a better one to just, you know, if we take the first, even if we had like one module built and we were like able to pull in the top, the next three to-dos due on each of our active six projects into this dashboard. Like, so simple. If we could just do that, it's almost like you've overcome one step. And then maybe it's like, let's pull up the however many invoices you have that are over a month due that you need to reach out to. Wouldn't that be, you know, make it easier? That's just front and center to you every day, so you don't let that stuff go. But each of those, and so we got to learn Asana's API, we've got to learn Harvest's API. In some cases, we want to manipulate the data, and that's another challenge. But we could take it, I think, in small chunks, and over the course of maybe 2 years, have something decent built. I know other developers have done it for their own business to just have a high-level view of things, and maybe we'd license it, maybe we wouldn't. But I do think there's probably room for something like that in the marketplace, because everything that we've tried that was all-inclusive to replace all those systems didn't seem to do the trick for us.
Yeah.
This is at least fairly flexible, where you could say, okay, maybe you don't use Asana, maybe use Basecamp instead. So it's like, okay, let's rework this module to work with Basecamp's API instead. But
ultimately, it's there's a module for your bookkeeping, whatever, that's front books, FreshBooks or Harvest or something else.
Yeah.
Or you take the top three, you know, platforms, whatever. One for project management and Slack. What would go on Slack?
I don't know.
Slack to me, like the latest group message. I mean, you know what I mean? Like, I feel like you could probably put something else in there. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe it isn't Slack, or maybe it's the other way. Maybe it's like, hey, your dashboard's just been refreshed, shows up in the Slack channel. I don't know. I don't know what it would be. Maybe there's not as much of a need for that. It is in my head. It was more around, oh, I remember what I was going to do. It was, actually, I have the wireframe in here somewhere. I had a all the most recent activity in the left sidebar or whatever. So you just saw a stream of the recent things that have happened.
That'd be cool. Yeah,
just something more fun than anything else.
Yeah.
But not really. Does anything need to be written in the dashboard that would go post back to Slack? Not necessarily. It'd just be cool to see.
I think it'd be good to have a 50,000-foot view. And I like when Slack sends out those the analytics reports. It just talks about DMs versus group conversations versus whatever it is. I think those are kind of just interesting. But,
that was all it was. But I kind of like that idea of stats too, even like a counter of how many messages have been sent today, if that's even possible. Oh, probably the other big reason why I had thought to do this is we're still, I always feel like I forget, like, what's the tentative launch date for this thing? What's the dev turnover date for this? Like, I just need a calendar of some sort of, here's everything that's going on. Here's when we're going to get this project that we can start. Here's when we're expected to deliver this project. So that's just an area where there's key dates on there. I don't think Asana does that really, really well. So that might be something that we have an interface for that specifically, is just internal calendar.
Timeline visibility,
resource planning. Yes.
Well, that'd be pulling in. What would be awesome is to pull in the Google calendar. If there was a way to...
That is perfect, yes. Yeah. Kind of how we do with vacations. We put in the vacations calendar that everybody can see and add to. It would be nice to have one for projects as well.
I wonder if you can... We wouldn't use a Google Calendar for project management necessarily, but if there was, maybe we would. I don't know.
I'd love it. I mean, if Ellie just put together that calendar for Grid, it would be nice if that was somewhere other than, I don't know where it is right now. It's probably in a project folder buried somewhere.
Right.
But so if I really want to get an idea of what does work look like in July, I have to kind of, do I have to go to like six project folders and look at timelines where we only have timelines for two of them? And then, oh, I forgot about it.
What about Asana's timeline?
Same thing, calendar. I actually liked Basecamp's calendar a little bit better because theirs was based on milestones. Asana's calendar, what it does is it puts all the to-dos on the calendar with their due dates, so everything is mixed together. It's not like you can say only put milestone events on the calendar unless something has changed there. But I don't want to see all the to-dos. I want to see
key
dates. Yeah, like when are the big ones? Because even this one we're supposed to be almost done with, and I can't remember if the launch date was July 8th or July 13th, and that's a really big difference.
Yeah, somewhere in there.
So I spit out the 13th the other day on the client call and waited for anybody to say anything different. They didn't, so I guess it's July 13th. But I'm like, I can't find the data anywhere. So that's all I was really looking for. And it might be maybe just like me and you and Chris and Ellie use it or something, just to get that, keep that high level view when a lot of stuff's happening that we're not as involved in anymore. You still, you have that portal, portal into the business.
Agency portal. Yep. I think that's what it's all about.
Yep, exactly. So anyways, like I said, I don't know if it'll ever come to fruition, but it's probably, maybe it's something similar to your poster a week, where sometimes it's just nice to think about something else other than something with a deadline or something that has to meet somebody else's need. Right. You want to think about, oh, well, you know, to me, this has felt like something that would be really helpful.
Well, so what would this, what would it take it? if Leo started something, you know, you wireframed it just to get the a working model down? I mean, is this...
Yeah, like, and that's true.
He is could, it a week? Could, yeah. Is it?
Oh, no. I think it's way more. I don't know. I think there's a lot more of this type of stuff that needs to happen. It's probably a several month project, I would think, to define it well. And I mean, sure, could he go build like one little piece that maybe pulled in the top, you know, the next three do items on six projects from Asana? Probably. Mm-hmm. You know, or could he just go build this calendar thing where Ellie could go plug in some key dates for all our projects and have it listed out in chronological? Sure, we could like build a module maybe at a time, but I think it's the whole thing to do it well and get everybody's input and all that, I think would take quite a bit of time. I don't know, it'll be in the background for a while, something that would
so this is something that would, it couldn't get done in a month. This is
right exactly kind of exactly stuff. I think so, yeah.
All right, well, very ambitious.
Yes, that's what I heard. And maybe there's another part of it. Like, is there something that we could do in a month that would get a, like, you know, two modules done or whatever in a month that are just, it's really basic, but I'm afraid of doing it too simple and then we don't use it at all and then lose energy to improve on it. I'd rather have something that's fairly well-rounded right off the bat that maybe we start using and we're like, oh my God, this is so awesome. Or if we start using it, it's like, well, we've got kind of what we thought we really wanted and it still sucks, we never use it. Then that says something too, then let's stop and figure it out.
Yeah, I think this is like the never-ending battle for agencies. There's actually an agency I have to find. I saw it on LinkedIn. They're actually coming out with their own technology platform for the, you know, project management kind of tools and stuff. And what works in one agency doesn't work in another. We're at a level where you know, we're not big enough to take advantage of a product-like advantage. You know, it almost needs its own, you almost need an employee or employees to pilot that thing. Not pilot like pilot program, but like literally hands-on keyboard managing that all day or most of the day. And you have to serve the beast, right? Well, we're at a place where we're running so fast 95% of the time that to manage one of these systems is the pain in the butt. But there's no one system that does multiple things. Right. So you're right, we're always bouncing between harvest and going, like, I'm constantly trying to figure out, or bouncing between harvest and Slack and timesheets, and it's maddening.
Yeah.
it really is.
Yeah.
It's like, can't anybody figure this out? I like your idea a lot. I think it's kind of interesting. You'd have to almost probably do a lot of, there's probably data out there somewhere, research out there about like what agencies are really using, you know, in terms of Slack and Harvest or FreshBooks or whatever it is. But if you could actually build something like that and then become this like portal or a layer on top of all these other products, and then it'd be start getting kind of complex. It'd be kind of cool.
Yeah, and I can't decide if that really is the right answer, if it's this layer built on top of all the existing products. But what I came to is when we were researching and we tried out a bunch of the agency management systems that tried to replace all of our existing systems, there were always shortcomings in some areas. One did one really well, one did the other did, you know, really well, but it, maybe one was missing something that we had in QuickBooks, or this was missing something from a project management aspect that we really find valuable. Mm-hmm. That's kind of when my head moved to, maybe this is just a dashboard that lets you interact with all these systems and so makes it look like it's just one piece of software, but you really are utilizing these. Harvest does, you know, invoicing and time tracking extremely well. Let's not rebuild Harvest. Let's hook into Harvest and use it as part of the framework. Asana does project management really, really well, or list management, probably better said. So let's keep that in place. But that's where I kind of got into, when I started to get into this, it's like, okay, if you click on a to-do in from the, our dashboard, does it take you to Asana and open Asana? I don't think so. I want it to all, like, I'd want us to eventually be able to interact with everything right through this dashboard and not still go open a new tab or whatever. So maybe it'll change. Maybe we'll say, you know what? Well, we know Harvest does invoicing and time tracking really well, so let's replicate what they did. Let's rebuild it. That sounds even more daunting. it would take even longer, but I figure we got to start somewhere. And if it doesn't go anywhere, that's fine. But at least to let my brain go somewhere else for a little bit. So,
well, the core problem is, I think, is the just project management software. Mm-hmm. Period. Like, to your point, Asana isn't really it's a list builder, and the calendar / timeline part of it is just isn't very useful. Yeah, and having to go through four different places on. Every day is just kind of crazy too. Every place I've been has had a custom solution that was built when the agency was of a certain size. Mm-hmm. And then the agency grew, and then the thing was either cumbersome or the technology changed. And you know, this is like the never ending battle for most people. Maybe there's better solutions out there now at some larger agencies. I've, you know, even at JWT when I was there for a while, God, what did we have? Actually, they had a pretty complex project management system. God, it was whatever. It was a long time ago. But
they built it, or they had it built, or it was one of those package solutions customized for them?
That's a good question. I don't remember. I'm going to guess. So they're part of a huge network. They're one of the biggest, oldest agencies in the world, basically. And I can't remember if they're part of WPP or they're one of the big two networks that's not Omnicom. But they've got all the resources in the world, and they probably built their own. Mm-hmm. I'm guessing, but it's been a while since. And actually, the office that I was creative director at for a while was before it was JWT. JWT bought it. Previous to that, it was a software company. Mm-hmm. So they may have had some kind of like their own tool that they just kind of morphed into JWT's management. For that particular office, because they probably had something that JWT bought it just came with the agency, may have had something that they used, and it was JWT for like 4 or 5 years. And so, my point is, the software company wasn't like so far ancient history that it would have been changed. But anyway,
interesting.
Anyway.
I know Modern Tribe built their own, and internally, you know, they're a design development company, so they just went through and scoped it and built it all themselves.
What'd you call them?
Well, I think that's about the limit. You know, they built it for themselves. They were like, we knew what we wanted, what our problems were, so we solved them internally by doing our own project. But it's because they had gone through a lot of the same trial and error with other systems that already existed, failed with every one of them. So they were like, all right, let's just
Did they use Harvest and Asana?
No, I don't think so. I don't know how far it would be interesting. Yes, I would like to talk to them, not to say, hey, can we have your system? But more, did you build in your own invoicing and time tracking into this, or is it all project management? Mm-hmm. Or how much did you really hook everything together, or did you really rebuild a bunch of wheels? I don't know. It would be interesting to see how they tackled it. Actually, Jason Siffring, now that I think about this, he had a dashboard for his own freelancership. Mm-hmm. Jason Siffring is a developer, was WordPress and Expression Engine developer. So he developed just a quick like HTML dashboard of top line, I think, like business result type things. So when I'd written down, it'd also be cool, like for me, I'd love to log in and be like, hey, here's how much we've build so far this month, here's what the goal is for the month, maybe here's how many hours here's how many hours Leo's got in that have been billable so far this week, to make sure we're just like tracking these little things ongoing to make sure we're not falling off or identifying issues way too late in versus goals or where we need to be. But anyways, so he had a similar dashboard with that kind of top line business result or what's coming next, what, you know, date wise, that did use other systems in the background. It wasn't like he rebuilt all these modules. He just used APIs, I believe, to pull it all into a high level, you know, status view of everything. It's kind of like the company intranet, right? Like you get into work and you go to, you know, we had one at P&G, and it was like, what's the latest news and where's the stock price at? And you know, is there going to be a fire drill today? And what, you know, all that kind of stupid stuff. But I, to me, it's more about results.
Whose birthday is it?
Yeah, exactly. Happy birthday, Patrick Smith. Yeah, you'd love that. I'll have to find a way to say, if is anyone's birthday except Patrick Smith, say happy birthday, yeah. Person name.
I'm not opposed to birthday acknowledgments. What I'm opposed to is a big production around it.
Oh,
that's,
see, I kept my mouth shut. Yeah, I behaved. Yeah. I was like, I don't. I've. It's it, to yeah. me. Your birthday is eggshells. I have to be careful.
Not so much here. I think in a previous environment, it may have been.
I gotcha. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. You didn't want cupcakes and singing.
I didn't want cupcakes and singing. I'm not.
Yeah.
There.
I hear you. Most people don't, I don't think.
Yeah.
Ryan Irwin likes it. Yeah. He's the only person I've ever heard say, I like when people do that. I can't stand it either.
Yeah,
but I suck it up. I mean, whatever.
Yeah. I just don't like that kind of attention. And yeah. And I didn't want a production out of it either. I think it's kind of.
Yeah. No, so. I don't think so either. I think it's nice to acknowledge people, you know, that's kind of the base thing. I'm just like, you know, hey, today's Emil's birthday. Happy birthday, Emil. What, you know, whether we'll get, does everybody need to get in and sign a card? I don't know, but maybe it's something that we should be in touch with, though. Like, if other people are the ones that, like, maybe they'd be really offended if their birthday passes and we don't even say anything, or maybe know when their birthday is, or maybe they are expecting a little more of a to-do.
Which goes back to some of our culture values conversation we need to figure out soon, too. But anyway.
Well, let's add that to status next week as a current issue that we need to.
How do you guys feel about birthdays?
Yeah. I don't want to offend anybody because both you and I probably have a similar perspective on it. That, but I don't want to make that everybody's perspective either. Yeah. I just hope they don't want Christmas cards. Oh God, I don't want to, like. I don't know same thing. Like P&G, we got like a Christmas package and a Christmas card from the company and all these kind of things. Like how much do people care about the acknowledgement of some of that stuff? Like as they're. As an employee or affiliate of ours, I don't know.
Yeah, you get a nice, you know, coffee mug in there and a nice coaster.
Maybe. I don't know. You're better with that stuff than I am too.
You're a valued employee. I hope you enjoy this coaster.
I think it's better to acknowledge like small things happen. Not that Emil's twins are small, but like that's huge. Like that's a big deal. Let's acknowledge that. Or even like Ellie with her daughter getting a bee sting. Like I would rather acknowledge these things that happen in like life and let people know that we care about them in that way versus like, oh, here's your Christmas gift.
Right, than a shallow,
homogenized
corporate pull lever kind of thing.
Here's your flowers because it's your birthday again this year. And you know, here's your card signed by everybody in the
team. I think what you're saying is you want something that's authentic versus kind of the, automatic, I don't know what the right word is, but just manufactured is probably, manufactured fun.
Yeah.
Manufactured acknowledgement.
Because everybody always, it's the blueprint, right? The blueprint for holidays and all that stuff. I just, I don't know.
Yeah.
Great. Sure.
Hey, speaking of, what's the Helio anniversary? I'm trying, what's your, do you have a start date? Or like what, your anniversary, whatever? I'm just curious.
How would you define that? Like, I don't know. I don't really have a date, I guess.
Well, I technically, I mean, according to the state of Illinois, I think I filed for my LLC, whatever, or corporation, I should say, yesterday is actually the technical.
Oh, really?
Yeah, anniversary. But I really, we celebrate it. You want to call that? And I'd much rather celebrate C2's anniversary than my birthday, but October 1st.
And I didn't even know. I feel so bad.
Yeah, October 1st.
Okay.
That's when we really started. I got the paperwork in July, but I wasn't doing C2 stuff.
So the IRS's date or whatever, whoever you did even file the paperwork with, the
State of
like,
Illinois, Secretary of State.
Okay, so the state has what date? Yesterday or
yesterday,
October?
Yeah.
But you really started doing work the October or the year before as C2.
No. That later that year.
Oh, so you had all the business structure like figured out, and then later on is when you.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I didn't know that. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
In what year? 2009. 2009. Okay. Interesting.
Yeah.
Mine screwed up because I had different business names and like purposes of like what was were it?
Heather
really
Acton
doing?
Computer Repair, was that one of them?
That was actually part. That was part of it. It was Acton Web and Computer Services because
a great name.
Yeah, just wonderful. I didn't know you yet, so it was all me. But it was just reformatting people's stupid old PCs, you know, and getting them running fast again, or if they had a broken port or something, ordering the part, and it was ridiculously bad. Nobody, for how cheap PCs are, there's no sense in paying anybody any decent money to fix these things because you could go buy a new PC for $400. So that dropped. But anyway, I think that Acton Web and Computer Services, I don't even know that I ever set up like an LLC or anything for it. Yeah. But I was doing, that's when I started doing web development stuff too. And then I had a couple other ones. And so I think my date with the state is like 2011, mm-hmm. something like that. I don't know when I finally did. And then the business name changed like 3 times. I don't know. It was all a mess, so I don't know my date. Yeah. February 2009 is when I got my first laptop that I really started to do work with. So I would call it February 2009.
Okay.
That's kind of when I say we've been here for 8 years or whatever. Yeah. I've been doing this for 8 years. That's where I get that.
I'm just curious, just from was there any synergies with dates? But that's good.
Yeah, not really, I guess.
It's fine.
Yeah.
February 1st or February 14th? Is it Valentine's Day, the anniversary of Helio?
God, I hope not. I don't know. I'd have to look at, like, my delivery receipt for the Mac that came that day.
Yeah.
But and that Mac is still alive and kicking, too.
Really?
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
Kids use it to play video games on and stuff.
Yeah, you said 2009? 2011,
sorry. Is this right? Addie was born December 2008, and, yeah, it was right after she was born that I got it. So, yeah, February 2009. Okay. It was a 17-inch MacBook Pro, big, thick as MacBook Pros go, you know, but the big screen was pretty nice. But it operates well. It's a little slow starting up, but, I mean, for a computer that's that old, that it even still works at all is kind of unbelievable.
Yeah.
But anyways.
Yeah, I've got one like that where it's just basically a TV or, you know, or a jukebox, whatever, but it plays music and I watch videos on it. That's about it.
Yeah, that's what I need it for. Still works.
All right. Well, this was a great conversation about timeline visibility, and that was cool. To be honest, I think we talked a little bit about this on the surface, or maybe not at all, or I saw it in Slack or whatever. But so I'm glad.
The internal dashboard.
Yeah. So it's cool to hear more about it. Yeah. So yeah, nice, good deal.
It's fun.
All right. Well, I think that's it for episode 7. Yeah. Yeah. Whatever.
Somewhere.
All right. Thanks for listening today.
Bye.